Hi, I'm Angela Bishop and welcome to Bish's Biz. He's one of Hollywood's most bankable stars and also one of Hollywood's nicest stars. He's Matt Damon, and whenever he comes to town, we roll out the red carpet with a little extra care. This time he's promoting the movie Elysium, a sci-fi adventure that touches on some hot-button political topics. In Matt Damon's new movie Elysium, it's all about the haves and the have-nots. The haves live on a space station far above Earth, where medical advances mean they never get sick, while the have-nots live on the rubbish dump Earth has become. What attracted you to this? Why did you want to go on board?
It was really the director, Neil Blomkamp. He did a movie called District 9, which I thought was just phenomenal and really interesting and unique and everything I look for, you know, as a movie fan. And so when he came along with this movie, I just jumped at the chance to work with him.
They will hunt you to the edge of the earth for this.
What is it?
It's a reboot program for Elysium. Whoever has this has the power to override their whole system. Open the borders. Make everyone a citizen of Elysium.
It wasn't a walk in the park. For starters, the filming in Mexico, how was that on a real dump?
Yeah, it was the second largest garbage dump in the world. And it was, so that was challenging, but we were only there for about 2 weeks. And you know, in talking to Neil about it, he said, look, when have you ever seen a big action set piece in a futuristic movie set in a third world garbage dump? It was a really kind of great idea and perfect kind of thematically for this movie. A Bugatti Veyron spaceship crashes in a garbage dump. It's kind of the perfect visual expression of the themes of the movie with the haves and the have-nots.
Proving almost that the haves and the have-nots already exist. This isn't really a situation of something that can only happen in the future.
Yeah, I think with any good science fiction, whether it's set in the future or a long time ago in a galaxy far, far away, you're really talking about where, you know, how the world is now.
Stop right there, and you're going to do exactly what I say, or I'm going to blow my head off. You understand? You can have everything in my head. Just take me up there and get me in a med bay. What I have is very valuable.
We can fix you up. Put you in the med bay, sort all this gaga.
What was it like for you to work with Matt Damon on this? Did you guys know each other?
No, I never met him. And it was really a blessing. It was something that, it's one of the things that I sort of take away from the film. And somebody was asking me that, you know, what is sort of your memory of the film? And I was saying, in a weird sort of way, it's just that relationship with Matt, and sort of, he's just got so many sort of qualities and things that I admire, and we got on very well with regard to just having debates about the world, with regard to our passion for film, and all aspects of film. And I found him an interesting, almost sort of in a certain way, I mean, sounds cheesy, but almost role model-like in the sense of how he's able to keep his family life together in a business that is as crazy as this. My life's been turned upside down since District 9, and trying to keep some sort of semblance of normality is very difficult. And he's one of the very few people I've come across that seems to do it very well.
I'm authorizing a full containment order. Issue a no-fly zone for Los Angeles. Until we apprehend him, no one leaves the surface of that city.
A lot of it running around with your shirt off, but some hardware on, so to speak. How was that?
That was, it was amazing actually that the guys at the Weta Workshop in New Zealand were able to build this thing and make it as mobile and light as it was. But it did take about 3 hours with all of the other prosthetics and stuff that I had to get fitted into every morning. It was about 3 hours in the makeup chair. So that was all, but as a guy who's got four kids, like I loved having 3 hours to myself every morning. Reading the paper while they were all working.
Looks as though you may have done a sit-up or two, too, in the lead-up to it. You're looking pretty fine.
Yeah, that was a lot of work also. You know, I'm 42 now, so that it's not as easy as 22 to get in shape.
Attention incoming vessels. You are in violation of Elysium airspace.
Dad,
return to Earth, or we will be forced to take immediate action.
Jodie Foster, also on board, looking amazing, but also, what a great evil dude.
Yeah, she's just amazing, and I loved her look. I mean, she's like just all business, you know, and that's what the character was. And you know, I had one scene with her. I wish I had more, but I mean, when I, you know, 20 something years ago, when she won the Hasty Pudding Award and I was at Harvard, I went, you know, along with hundreds of other people to see her receive the award, just because I was a big fan of hers. So to kind of come full circle and get a chance to actually work with her was great.
One last job for me, you earn your way up.
What is it?
Take a billionaire. He's down on Earth for some business, he's here for whatever, we hijack him. Relax, forget his watch, forget his ride. This is what you take. Organic information, right out of his head. Now I'm talking about bank codes, passwords, login data. Access to billions. All you have to do is plug into his brain, download the data into yours with this baby, and bring it to me.
This is crazy, Max. Come on.
Once we verify the data, I'll give you a one-way ride, all expenses paid.
Asylum seekers are an enormous issue here, and it's something you can't help but, you know, recognize when you see this film.
Yeah.
What do you think people can take away?
Well, I don't think Neil wants to offer a solution to any problems. I think he's more interested in creating a world to kind of show our world and then leave it to the audience, you know, and
start a conversation.
Yeah, exactly. I think he, you know, in talking to him, he's like, well, if people just want to enjoy the film on a literal level, that's fine. You know, like with District 9, you know, some people don't want to talk about apartheid or, you know, they just go like, I just love that movie, you know, where the guy kind of morphed into an alien, you know, and with this, it's the same thing. Like if you don't feel like engaging in those issues, you don't have to. But if you do, I think it's a cool conversation starter.
You know, these are the types of things that Neil and I talk a lot about. What I always find interesting is I see Neil, and having known him for such a long time, as a satirical artist. I feel pretty similar about, you know, in terms of myself as well. I would say that I'm interested as a, I wouldn't say I'm as much of a political person as I am a satirical person. I mm-hmm. love things like South Park and, you know, stuff that looks at... And what you see happening in America, for example, is you do a film like this that has certain metaphors. In a certain way, you could argue that the film is almost a metaphor for how we live now in certain countries and in certain societies.
You do comment on things political from time to time when they are important to you. Movies are a great way to start a conversation in that manner, aren't they?
I think so, yeah. You know, I don't think they necessarily move the needle, but if you can tell a good story, I think that's a good way to get some of these things. You know, I mean, the way that we've passed information on since the beginning of time was by telling stories to one another. And you know, I always think of like a movie like The Matrix. It had really interesting stuff in it that had I gone to see the Wachowskis lecture about, you know, 10, 12 years ago, I wouldn't remember it, but because it was told to me in such an artful and unique way, like, I still think about that stuff.
Just made a movie with Cate Blanchett, Monuments Men, George Clooney. Do you have time to catch up? Do you have time to do anything but be here for the red carpet or catch up with her while you're here?
No, we were supposed to come yesterday and the flight got canceled, so we're literally here and leaving at like 5 in the morning, so... It's one of those, it's a crazy trip, which is sad because I haven't been here in 6 years and I would have liked to have stayed for a little while, but it wasn't meant to be this time.
Come back again soon. Bring the kids, bring the family, make a movie here.
That's what I have to do. I got to make a big movie down here.
I think I can help get you up there.
This ain't gonna kill me. What did you do to me?
Whoever has this has the power to override their whole system.
For her sake, Max, we need to get her up there.
You can save everyone.
When can I go? Follow me. Stay close.
Activate Kruger.
That's all for now. See you next time.